Good morning. Welcome, everyone, on this what's hopefully going to be a beautiful fall day. If we look at some of our announcements, we have harvest festivals tomorrow. We talked about the shoebox packing party that's happening next Sunday. And there's pizza that's going to be provided as an incentive for everybody to show up and just help. It should be a fun time. Just everything gets piled on tables and you just go around and grab them and pack your little boxes, so should be fun. And anything with pizza is always even more fun. And then harvest dinner coming up. So I just want to recognize all of the volunteers that it takes to make these events successful. You know, the congregation our size to be able to put on some of these events, like cooking a harvest dinner or putting together hundreds of shoe boxes or doing a community event with for Harvest Festival where we play games and hand out candy. It's just awesome that we have a congregation that can just come together and put on these events, and it takes so many volunteers to do that and so much work. So I just want to just give thanks for everybody that, in Foodlink too, the same thing. We just have so many people that come together for our church that can do so much good for the community. So I just wanted to thank everybody for everything that, and everybody that participates in helping out to make these successful. So let's just go to prayer. Oh Lord, we thank you. Thank you that we have people that are able to organize and coordinate and just put all of these events together. Followers of you that have a heart for these events. And we just give thanks for all the people in the congregation that come together and support to make all of this a success. In addition, we lift up all of the tithes and offerings, and we just ask for prayers over them as they help further your kingdom. In your name, amen. And opening scripture, James 5, 19 through 20. Well, this is an eye test. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this: whoever turns a sinner from the error of their ways will save them and death from death and cover over the multitude of sins.
Will you stand and worship the Lord together with us through singing?
Lord, hear our prayer. So this morning we come to a time of confession and assurance, and again, what we do as a church family is we go back and we look at the past sermons for the past month and just pray over those, especially a week before communion. And so we want to take the time out to do that this morning. And so the first passage for our confession is going to be from Matthew chapter 7, verses 1 through 5. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged. With the assurance you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank of your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when all the time there's a plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we come to you and just ask you that as we come together as a church family and as we talk about just really confrontation and confronting others and their sin, that first and foremost that we think about this passage and we step ourselves and the planks, the logs in our eyes that you've taken out first. And this passage, of course, is not talking about that we shouldn't be discerning against our doing, but that instead we should live our lives full of the gospel and truth, and in that we examine our lives and see those logs in our eyes that they need to be removed. And so we, Lord, solemnly confess that you show us the logs in our own eyes this morning that we might bring them to you in repentance. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Here now verses of assurance from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting in verse 8. Love never fails, but there are prophecies that will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. But there is knowledge will say, for we know in part, we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I taught like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we come to you and just ask you that we would see your truth, that despite our sin, as this verse really seems to be alluding to, that we will spend eternity with you and all these earthly things will pass away. And so, Lord, we pray that we understand this wonderful, amazing truth that your love will never fail us and that we will spend eternity in heaven with you. And we thank you for that. We praise you for that. And we ask you in all these things, we live in the light of the gospel. That as we are taking the logs of out of our eyes, we are reminded consistently, constantly, that we are forgiven as your children and one day reside in heaven with you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand if you're able? Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, Wendy, and Kristen. So this morning, if the children would come forth for the children's sermon. And as they're coming forward, we will do New City Catechism question number 44. The question is, what is baptism? Baptism is the washing with water in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It signifies and seals our adoption into Christ, our cleansing from sin, and our commitment to bring to the Lord and to His church. Okay. So, how are you guys doing today? Good. So, I have a question, especially for my three boys, and that is, sometimes you, like all children, and like I did when I was your age, sometimes I do things that I shouldn't. And you, when that happens, you get in trouble, right? Right? And so, you know, that always kind of happens sometimes. And that's, you know, and then you get disciplined. You get corrected, right? And so, but what's important, though, is when, as this happening or right after you're disciplined, something really important always happens that I always try to. So, Jeremiah, could you come here? I asked him beforehand. So whenever that happens, it's like, okay, Jeremiah, did this, you get your discipline, whatever that is. And then I say, but you know what? I love you. I love you. And I give him a hug, right? And you're always there during that time and all, which is, don't fall down. Okay, right? But I always try and do that, like every single time that you guys get in trouble, because I want you to know I try as much as possible to do it with gentleness. And sometimes I even, like, remind you guys, hey, you know what? When I was your age, I probably did the same thing, because I'm a sinner. And so, thank you, Jeremiah. Good job. And so, that's really important to know. And the reason why we do that, though, is because whenever we sin, much in the same way, God is our Father, comes and loves us and tries to restore us. And oftentimes what he'll do is he'll use people within our church family in order to do that, so that he comes, and it talks about this morning, as we're going to talk about, in a gentle way. A way that's to bring them to restoration. And that's really, really, really important to know. So that as you go through life, there's going to be some times as a Christian, as a child of God, that you might have to talk to somebody about what's called sin in their lives. But when you do so in a way that's very loving, very caring, and very gentle. Because that's what God wants us to do, because that's how God treats us. He doesn't let us go in our sin and the wrong things that we do, right? But he always does it in a very kind, gentle way. And so in the same way, that's what we should do, okay? Can you guys remember that? All right, let me pray for you guys. Heavenly Father, just thank you, Lord, for all these children, and we pray, Lord, that they all come to know and understand not only that they need sometimes to confront people with their sin as they grow up as Christians in the life of the church, but also to be able to hear when others talk to them about their sin, and they receive it in a humble, gentle manner, a gentle manner. And so we pray, Lord, that for these little ones as they grow up and to be part of the church family as your children, that they come to understand these important things. So that they can be salt and light wherever they live. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, you go back to see me now. So this morning we have a few prayer requests. First is Mary White, and Jody is bringing this prayer request. Many of you might know her. She is from the Methodist Church. And again, Mary White, and she's diagnosed with severe bone cancer, and the doctors has given her only a few months to live. So just be in prayer for her and her family and everybody that knows her. And also pray for David Hahn for strength and nerve repair in his legs, as we've been praying for him. Great to see him at church. And also we have been praying for John J.C. Stacy, and he had to be rushed to the hospital. This is Ron's child, and he had to be rushed to the hospital, I believe, on Thursday, and because he wasn't breathing very good. Thankfully, he's back home now, but just continue to keep him and his family in your prayers and know that they would deeply appreciate it. So for our time of prayer this morning, we will consider read from Matthew 18, verses 15 through 17. Matthew 18, verses 15 through 17. Hear now the word of God. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. If they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or tax collector. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we come to you and we lift up these prayer concerns to you, these new prayer requests, such as Mary White and J.C. Stacy. And just them up and lift them up in your hands. And Lord, in particular, I know that our hearts are heavy for Mary and her family and friends and all those that know her. And just pray your healing hand would be upon her, that a miracle would happen here and that she'd be healed. But throughout all this, we pray for just for strength and guidance as she battles this terrible cancer, Lord. We lift up other prayer concerns to you, Lord, that we've been praying for a while, including David, and pray that strength continues to get strength and healing. And we lift up Bev Rogers, who's now receiving a lot of pain and right now, and she's had setbacks. She was doing great from her surgery, but now, Lord, she's back and having a lot of pain. And so we just lift up Bev and just ask your healing hand be upon her. Other prayer concerns, Lord, that we have been praying for a long time, Lord, and that we will continue to pray for, such as Joe Frawley and as well as Don. Also continue to lift up Kay and her family as they miss Ron terribly. And so, Lord, these things that we pray for physical healing and also spiritual healing as well. We lift up tomorrow's Fall Festival to you and just pray that we might be salt and light in this community and might share the love of Jesus with those that are lost, Lord. Lord, we think of this passage from Matthew 18, and it's just a reminder to us of how the steps that we are to take when we see a brother or sister that sins. And so often, Lord, we just ignore the passage altogether, and we just either excuse sin away or we gossip about it. But Lord, there are very, very clear steps that we are to take when someone's and a fellow believer sins. And so Lord, we pray that we follow these steps and especially Lord, that we not be gossips, as I know it can happen very easily before we even realize it. And so that we might be salt and light in our community, that we might share the love of Jesus with those around us. And as a church family, we come together as your children, and we pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and glory forever. Amen.
Will you stand if you're able?
Thank you.
Seated.
Amen. Thank you all. Alden included, and he wasn't up here last time. So I have to say that I think that all my children love music from the earliest of ages. Maybe it's because Marty sings to them and just has a wonderful voice, but I think my daughter Lydia, if you notice, really has the moves. Again, it's great and wonderful to see and have her be part of the church family. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. And as we read this, it's, of course, today is confronting others, and it's the art of confrontation, namely sin. But what I want you to notice, though, is that I want you to pay attention and look at it carefully, because if you'll notice, it's not really even talking about the one that we're confronting. It's about somebody else. And so look at it really, really carefully, because I think this is really telling of us, because whenever we come to a passage like this, I don't know about you, but my tendency is to go, all right, this is going to tell me I can get it to others. And it's not really the case at all, because Paul will spend much more time on the person who does the correction, than the person that he's talking about confronting, much more time. And so just pay attention to this as we read it. Really concentrate on verses 1 through 5, but I really think that verse 6 has a connection to verse 5, and so we really want to read that as one as well. So hear now the word of God, Galatians 6, verses 1 through 6. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught into sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you may also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. If anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. Each one should test their own actions. Then they can take pride in themselves alone, without compromising themselves to someone else. For each one should carry their own load. Nevertheless, the one who receives instruction in the word should share all good things with their instructor. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning, we pray that we would understand your truth and we seek to apply it to our lives, and that we understand how we do go about confronting others and the process by which that happens, and even where our heart should be in that manner of confrontation, so that we are see your truth this morning and we might apply it to our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So, again, there is this sort of confrontation that it talks about in verse 1. But if you notice the rest of the passage, it really seems to be about the person that does the confrontation. And so I want us to start off there because, again, keep in mind what we talked about last week about taking those planks, those logs out of our eyes, first and foremost. And then we can see to take this back out of others' eyes. So let's do that before we get into verses 1 and 2. He says, if anyone thinks they are something when they are not, they deceive themselves. Again, just this aspect of don't really think that you're the hotshot, the go-to guy, or the go-to girl. And I would say that's something that's of all people in here, that's really hard for me to do. I've always said that pastors, if they're not honest, we struggle with pride the most, because we stand up in front of the congregation every week and we bring forth God's word, and the tendency for us is to think, I'm really something, look at me. And we shouldn't have that attitude. We should not have that attitude. And as we talked about it, when we talked about spiritual gifts, it's the ones who are not seen the least who are the most valuable. And so, really and truly, Paul wants us to get us to see if anyone thinks they're something when they are not, they deceive themselves. And we've got to understand that. We've got to apply that. And each one should test their own actions. In other words, this the second half of Galatians is filled with things that as Christians we're called to do and called not to do. And so we should seek Paul's words and should test our actions against what he's truly saying. In other words, let's take a look at ourselves and take out of our logs that we have. Then they take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. So some people think that Paul is being sarcastic here. Because in all honesty, if all of us have problems with pride one way or the other, right? I do. Again, preachers, if we're honest with ourselves, we have problems with pride and we constantly be on our guard. But honestly, have you ever been prideful without comparing yourself to somebody else? I mean, seriously, think about it. There are times that we all struggle and deal with arrogance and pride, right? And as you do so, you're always going to tend to compare yourselves to somebody else. Paul says you should take pride in themselves alone without comparing themselves to someone else. Now, again, if he's not being sarcastic, it's still something that we should heed, that we should be like, okay, if I can't look at what God is doing in my spiritual gifts and not compare myself to other people, then I just don't need to look at those spiritual gifts and think about those things. I've just got to put that out of my mind as much as I possibly can. Because I don't need to compare myself to other people. I need to compare myself to God. And if I compare myself to other people, then there's always going to be somebody who's better than I am. There's always going to be somebody who's better at what you do the best. There just always is. And so we always need to understand that. Again, if you can have a sense of self-worth and pride and But God has blessed the spiritual gifts that God has blessed you with without comparing yourselves to other people. Great. But that's pretty difficult. And then he says, for each one should carry their own load. In other words, especially when he's talking about not having a sense of pride. As we'll see later on, carry another's burden. So in other words, I really think what he's talking about here is each one of us should carry our own load ourselves and examine ourselves to make sure that we're not prideful ourselves, to make sure that we're not comparing ourselves to other people and coming across that way. And so we really need to carry our own load and examine our own lives. And so even he goes on to say, nevertheless, the one who receives instruction in the word should share all good things with their instructor. In other words, hey, you're not just ministering. I'm just not the one ministering to you. You constantly as a church family minister to me. And I love that. I cherish that. Even at times, the most difficult things. So speaking of which, with that kind of in mind, as we see what God has called us to be like, let's go back and look at verse 1. Because he says, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore them gently. But watch yourselves, or you may also be tempted. Now, a few things to note here, and that is, if somebody is caught in a sin, not somebody who's caught in a way that you think they should live. Not somebody who's caught acting in a way that you wouldn't act or approach something that the way that you wouldn't. Because let's be honest, in the life of a church and in other places, that can be our tendency, right? Is to, you're not doing this the way I want you to do it. You're not doing the way I would do it. No. Brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a what? A sin. S-I-N. What's a sin? It's something that goes against God's word. And so he's talking about somebody that's doing something that you can go directly to this Bible and you could say, look, you're my brother, you're my sister in Christ. Here's what the word of God says, and here's what you're doing. And if it's not like that, then understand, we need to be aware. Now, that's not to say we don't go to somebody and say, you know, hey, here's kind of what I think about this. Here's would be my approach. But that's far different from confronting sin. And typically what we do is, for the things that we feel that others should do the way that we would do it, we tend to get harsh. We tend to do that confrontation thing rather than sit down and talk about it. And when it comes to the sinful part, we just kind of oftentimes just, that's not what I would do. It's not for me. But, you know, hey, okay. That's always our tendency. And look, I even think that the Apostle Paul did this. Like in 1 Corinthians, he talks about, and I really think this is the context of persecution, it's best for you not to marry. But hey, this is not a commandment from God. This is just my advice. And so when we talk to others about sort of suggestions and things that this should be our approach, it's like, okay, this is not something that I can go to Scripture. God alone is Lord of the conscience, and you can take my advice or leave it. That's far different than seeing somebody that is doing something in Scripture that is very, very distinctly not, that is disobeying Scripture, that is disobeying God, and saying to that person, confrontation, here's what the Bible says to do, Here's what you're doing. So then what is to happen? You who live by the Spirit. Now, what does he mean by living, you who live by the Spirit? Because, again, Scripture seems to indicate that all Christians, when they become a Christian, receive the Holy Spirit. But there's also this aspect within the life of the Christian that there are people who quench the Holy Spirit, who the Holy Spirit just isn't nearly as active in their lives as they should be. And the more and more we have the fruit of the Spirit, in fact, that is what Paul talked about. The fruit of the Spirit in earlier chapter 5, 22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. So in other words, those who live in their lives like this pretty consistently, as we all should be the ones to restore that person. Now, again, just like the log, right, last week, this is not to say that, well, no, I'm not really living by the Spirit, so I'm not going to confront this person. No, it should be a thing of, you know, okay, I really see in my life that I am not living by the Spirit like I should, and I can't really confront this person yet, so I really, 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 really need to work on this fruit of the Spirit in my life. Again, I need to take the logs out of my eye. I need to work on being a person who has the fruit of the Spirit in their lives. Love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness, gentleness and self-control. This is what should be lived out in my life. And so it's not, again, this is not an excuse of not going about doing what we should be doing. So in other words, we're called to do this. We don't just excuse their sin away as we often do, but we're called to confront people when they see them sinning. But notice what it also says. Gently. You should do it gently. In other words, you should do it the way, if you were in their shoes, you would want it be done to you. That as a fellow believer, you would want a person to gently come and restore to you. I tried to sort of represent it to one of my sons, Jeremiah, in a very caring, gentle way. That I strive to do as a parent. I'm not saying I'm perfect, that I do it all the time, but this is, again, the goal of every parent, as well as the goal of every church member to other church members, that we should do in a very caring, loving way. So again, we don't excuse our sin, but we don't also just seek to hammer them away. In other words, there's this process of restoration, because it's not a sense of course, excusing their sin, but it's also not to see them destroyed, but to be restored. The word there that is used in restore is the same that's used for a medical term, to heal one's wounds. That this person is restored to their life as Christian, as believer. If I remember right, there's even within our EPC book of orders that there is a service of restoration, especially for those pastors, that if a pastor sinned and then has come to repentance, and after a period of time, you actually have a service of restoration, which is amazing. And it's all about the gospel then. It's all about how all sinners might be restored, not only to fellowship with God and to the Holy Spirit, but fellowship with other believers. But then he says again, hey, watch yourselves, or you may also be tempted. In other words, there's always needs to be a sense of humbleness, of understanding that, hey, I'm a sinner too. I could fall and do the very same thing that you're guilty of. I could fall into the very same thing that you're doing. And so there's this sense of, hey, you know, you need to be careful yourself. Watch yourself. Because you too can be tempted and you too could fall into the same trap that this person has fallen in. And honestly, whenever you confront a person with sin, because the tendency is always to kind of excuse it away, there's a tendency for us to say, oh, well, that's not really that bad, you know, and then ourselves, we could be tempted to the very same thing. Sadly, I've like known pastors who've tried to counsel spouses who are committing adultery. Then they commit adultery themselves with the person they're counseling. And so it's just a watch that they were called to do. And again, if we're doing what verses 3 through 5 talk about, then and understanding that, look, we don't need to be prideful about this, but understanding that we're human, sinful human beings ourselves. Then I love verse 2. Carry each other's burdens, and this way you fulfill the law of Christ. Wow. When you see and you know a brother or sister in Christ that has sinned, and sinned terribly, sometimes very oftentimes, they don't realize it, but they're in a burden. And I love it how Paul words it. They're caught in a sin. They're caught up in a sin. There's almost the sense that they have fallen, and they're in a perpetual state of sinning. And it's become a burden on them. After all, if they're truly Christians, they're truly believers, they truly have the Holy Spirit living within them, the convictor of sin, there is going to be this burden. And so Paul tells those who are living by the Spirit, as we all should, carry this person's burden. Come alongside them. Love them. Cherish them. Bring the word of God as truth to their lives. And in this way, we fulfill the law of Christ. In other words, we are called to come alongside them in a gentle, again, a gentle manner. And not just, yeah, this is what you're doing wrong, but actually even sit down and cry with them. What I've always talked about is that, you know, there are times that we lift up other people in prayer request for a spiritual battle that they're facing. But how can you know if it's a prayer request or gossip? Well, this isn't scripture, but what I've often seen is a good rule of thumb is where your heart is. If you are at the point of tears, if you are at your heart and your mind is at your point of tears. Now, some of you don't cry, okay? I understand that. But I'm talking about inside. You're so mournful over the sin and what this person is going through and this burden this person is carrying. Then we are called to pray for each other and go to people. Our hearts and our minds should see that as a person's burden, and we should be at the point of tears for that person and trying to help them carry that load. In other words, and even carrying the burden ourselves. And in this way, we fulfill the law of Christ. So what's the law of Christ? What's Galatians about? Right? I mean, what's Galatians about? Galatians is about salvation in Christ alone, apart from other things. And for that, they were particularly dealing with circumcision, but anything that it's Jesus, the point about Galatians, it is Jesus, faith in Jesus, plus nothing else, is truly faith in Christ. That's the law of Christ. It's the gospel. It's Jesus dying for our sins, and faith in him and him alone is the point about Galatians. Now, the thing about it is, we would expect a book like that to be what's known as antinomian. And I don't really pronounce that right, but it's against the law. It's basically saying, well, you just do whatever you want to do, right? Because that's the way our minds think. But it's just the opposite, because chapters, like, say, 4-6 is all about, I'm sorry, chapters 5-6 is all about these ethical standards by which Christians are called to live their lives. And the problem, apparently, in Galatia was that they were depending on other things. And hey, you think, okay, well, then I bet you their behavior was pristine. Apparently not. Because Paul is writing about all these things that they were doing to each other. And if you look at verse 15 of chapter 5, if you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you two will be destroyed by each other. So Galatia was not like any church that doesn't see the gospel as it is. They doesn't see the law of Christ. They're just going to go all over the place. And they're not going to truly see sin for what it is. So they're not going to live their life the way that God has called them to live. And so he puts what Apostle Paul did is he shoves the gospel, as always, shoves the gospel right in front and says, this is how we're to live out the gospel. This is the law of Christ that you're seeking to fulfill. In other words, it's what Paul does is, as he always does, he always brings it back to the gospel. He always brings it back to Jesus. And you think about trying to restore somebody without the gospel, without simply faith in Christ, salvation. I don't see how that's done. I can't even wrap my head around that. I mean, somebody's committed tremendous, terrible sin. How do you even restore a person like that without the gospel? How do you do what Paul talks about? How do you even confront sin in the first place? How do you confront your own sin without the gospel? Without the full knowledge that you've been forgiven in Christ. And so again, this is bringing us always back to who? Back to Jesus. Living by the Spirit and doing this gently and bringing out the gospel so that others around us can see that. You see, it's again, yes, it's the art of confrontation, but what's the art of confrontation? Put as always, as everything in the Christian life, putting the gospel first and seeking to restore that person gently. Along the while, watching yourselves, because yourself could be tempted, and Lord, forbid that I should sin, because you have redeemed me. I don't want to go on sinning. Jesus, you died for that sin. Out of love and gratitude towards you, I want, my desire is to live for you. I don't want to fall in the same sin. And that's how we bring others who's caught up in a sin back to repentance and faith, back to restoration, back to living their lives the way Scripture tells us to. Through what? The gospel. Always, always about the gospel. Telling that person, hey, you know, Jesus died for you. He died for you because he died for me. And you say that you're a Christian, you're a believer, but you're doing this over here, and this is totally contradictory to what Scripture teaches. Please don't live your life like this. Jesus died for what you're doing. Why go back to the same mud and mire and you're down? Rather, repent. Turn away from that sin and turn towards Jesus and be restored in a relationship with him. You think he's left you, but if you're truly a believer, he never has, nor will he ever. But have that relationship restored, not only to him, but to your church family as well. And so that we can live as brothers and sisters in Christ. Be restored. Be restored to the gospel and to your life as a Christian. Again, gently, tenderly, lovingly, with the full knowledge that we have worked in ourselves as we live by the Spirit, right? But we got to do it. It's the most uncomfortable things in life for the church. What God has called us to do. In other words, put the gospel in front for everybody to see, for others to see in our walk, in our talk with each other as we care and we love each other. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning we come to you and ask you, Lord, that our hearts and minds would be touched by your word, by your truth. And we see this in astonishingly beautiful ways. That as we are ministering to other people, touching other people's lives with the gospel and with your word, that sometimes we do have to confront others with our sin. We confront our sin first and foremost, but we confront other people's sin ourselves. We seek to carry their burden and restore them in a gentle, tender way so that their lives might be restored. Not only in relationship to you, so they not grieve the Spirit anymore, but also to the church family, that they be restored in restoration. Lord, not only do we are called to do this, but as a result, Lord, we have to do this ourselves, that we have to be open to correction, that we have to be open to our fellow believers coming to us and telling us about the logs in our eyes, how we are contradicting Scripture ourselves. So Lord, let us be humble and knowing what they're doing is just attempting to follow Scripture. That's all they're doing when they confront us with our sin. So may we be a people who love, not only love and care for you and what you've done for us, but we love and care for each other as fellow believers, fellow children in Christ, and who seek to follow your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Will you stand if you're able?
send out a benediction.
To him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you before his glorious presence without fault, with great joy, to the only God our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority, through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.